Welcome to Backyard Farmer. I'm your host, Kim Todd, and we are so glad you could join us down here at Union Plaza, beautiful and extremely warm Union Plaza for Backyard Farmer. As always, I'm joined on the panel by our experts from Nebraska Extension and Landscape Services. We have Tom Buzz Pollinator Weisling answering all those insect questions.
What's up, people?
We have Bill Kreuzer, who's going to be piloting us through all those turf and weed questions.
Oh, Lincoln.
We have Lauren Giesler, who will be stalking the wild rots and spots.
Always great to be here, Kim.
And rounding out the panel, we have Jeff Culbertson, and I couldn't think of anything cute to say about the landscape. Jeff, you're just going to cover it all.
I'll try not to sweat on anybody.
Exactly. Well, since this is a taped show, you will not be able to call in with your questions tonight, but you can always send us an email to byf@unl.edu. Please tell us where you are in the state. Give us as much information as possible. Make sure those pictures will open for us. We've had a little bit of an issue with some of them. A JPEG is awesome. You can also follow us on Twitter, Facebook, Pinterest, YouTube, iTunes, you name it, all that social media stuff. We always start our sessions, of course, with samples. And Tom, you have one that is gigantious and beautifulous. What is that?
I got some great stuff here, Kim. We've seen pictures of them before, and this is a nice dead one that's been pinned. This is a Cecropia moth. This is one of the largest moths that we have in the area. And these moths actually came out this spring, and the females went around. They'll produce a pheromone, and from miles and miles away, this nice little perfume, and a male will be attracted, and then they will mate. And after they mate, the female goes and she finds a host like maple, maybe apple, some type of a host, lays her eggs, the little eggs hatch, and then they start to feed, and then they start to grow. So what's special about it today, well, this is the moth, that's the cocoon over on this side. And what's special about today is I have some nice big plump larvae to show you, which is not what we usually get to do. Let's see if we can get it out of there. Behave. There it is. Okay.
Oh my
goodness. Nice big fat larvae sitting here eating some crab apple. And so these were pulled off of the host tree, which was, I think, crab apple, earlier this summer, and has been reared inside. And the reason they're nice when they're reared inside is they tend not to get parasitoids, and parasitoids are very detrimental to these things. They grow and they get nice and big, but then the parasitoids get them, and not that many make it to the adult stage. So what's going to happen with anything out in nature is these are going to feed on whatever they're on, maple or crab apple. They're going to eventually pupate, they'll crawl off to a limb or maybe against a building or a rock, and they'll construct the nice cocoon. And then next spring we'll have the moths out again.
They're just awesome. They look like they belong on one of those great NASA rockets to somewhere.
Let's put one on one.
All righty. All right, Bill, looks like a firecracker, but
yeah,
what is it?
It's remnant from this weekend. No, this is a grassy weed, and identifying any grassy weed is really challenging. And any kind of grass itself actually is pretty challenging. They all kind of look the same, look like grass, right? This one's kind of distinctive though. It's a warm season grass, windmill grass, and right, it's distinctive because the seed heads, when they start to develop, they start tight like this, and then as it becomes more and more mature, they kind of branch out at about 90 degree angles, and so you get this very distinctive look to them. Kind of looks like a windmill, and so this is a windmill grass. There's a warm season grass like crabgrass or goosegrass, so you'll see it growing in the middle of summer, especially when the cool season grasses are slowing down. Control of this grass is really difficult to achieve. There's only one real herbicide out there that works selectively for it, and that's Tenacity. And you can require sequential applications to take care of it. When you put the application down, you'll notice it will bleach it out. And what this herbicide does is it keeps the plant from making those green pigments to make sugar. And so if it can't make sugar, it slowly dies. And that's why we need sequential applications, because we need to slowly starve this plant of sugar. And it might take, you know, a couple weeks to do that. And if we just put one application down, the herbicide gets broken down naturally by the plant and the microbes in the plant, and then it recovers. So windmill grass is kind of troublesome grass. It's kind of cool and it's pretty distinctive.
All right, excellent. Thanks, Bill. Lauren, you have grass too. What's up with that?
I do. I've got a different problem though in grass. So, you know, right now where we're so warm, really conducive for brown patch, and we're starting to see that in a lot of lawns. So I brought along some leaf blades, and unfortunately it's so warm, they kind of curled up. So I'm trying to get them out here. I don't know if we'll get close enough or not. But the main thing I wanted to show, and if we can't see that real good, if our viewers have any turf problems where they're seeing patches of turf that's blighted or they're seeing stuff thin out, when it's warm like this, that's the time to really, you know, consider a brown patch, specifically if you're dealing with a fescue lawn, although as warm as it is, if we get humidity, you'll even see it in bluegrass as well. Really common. We see it pretty much every year, and something that you can do a few cultural things to try to manage it, but if you really want to keep it under control, it's probably going to take a fungicide. So just avoid those irrigations at the wrong time. Try to do morning irrigations to shorten that leaf wetness period. Make sure you're not fertilizing. I'm sure nobody's doing that this time of year, because that'll really aggravate it as well. And then finally look at using a fungicide, and most of the garden center fungicides are going to have activity on this disease.
All right, excellent. Thanks, Lauren. Okay, Jeff, so horses sweat, and you have a horse...
Chestnut.
And we're all sweating.
And we're all sweating, so that's my story. No, so the reason I brought this is, you know, as a reminder, and that just is, the Buckeyes are a personal favorite of mine. They flower nice. You can see this was a big flower stalk. It puts on a nut, which is ornamental and kind of fun to throw at the kids. And then it has these nice palmate leaves, so it produces some good shade for the yard. But this is a good time of year when you're out sweating in the yard to look around your yard and think, where would I really like to have a shade tree? And we don't think about it in the middle of the winter or certain other times of the year, but during the heat of the summer is a good time to think about, where do I want it placed in the yard? How big do I want it to be? And then that will guide you in kind of selecting the tree that is best suited for you. And our Backyard Farmer website has lots of information that can help you make that choice.
Excellent. Thanks, Jeff. And if you have an ash, good time to think about that shade tree. All right. So, gentlemen, we're going to start with our first round of picture questions. And mm-hmm. You get the first one, Tom.
Yes.
This is really fun. This is a COSAD viewer. And they actually think they have found something that eats bindweed. They found egg cases, they found voracious larvae chowing down on the leaves, they found a beetle. What is this that would actually eat bindweed, and can you entomologists not, you know, breed it by the bajillions?
No, well, we're not doing anything with the bindweeds, Kim.
I know. That's,
we're trying to promote insects to help that. Actually, that's really neat. That is a tortoise beetle. It's called the Argus tortoise beetle, and it's actually one that I've been finding out on milkweed, the adult on milkweed, when I've been doing my surveys across the state. And when I first collected and took pictures, I wasn't sure what it is, identified it. And what I ended up finding was the larvae on bindweed. So I was able to put the life cycle together, and then I could look it up and find out what the history is. It's called Argus. Anybody know on the panel what Argus is?
No.
Mythical monster with 100 eyes, or maybe more. But it's got a lot of eyes, so it stands for all those spots on the back. But the beetle will lay her eggs on bindweed, and that's about it. She'll lay her eggs on bindweed, and the larvae will start to eat the bindweed. And the larvae get really neat looking because they grow spines. They actually take their poop and throw it up on their back, and this is kind of a defensive mechanism against predators and parasitoids, and they'll rear up if you bother them. But then they eventually will reach the end of the life stage, pupate, and then the adults will really emerge. So they are really good insects to have around, and they do a number on bindweed. We just need more of them.
Excellent. Thanks, Tom. It's sort of a creepy idea, but good for them for the poop thing.
Yep.
Okay, so Bill, this is a great question, too. Matt answered a few of these last week,
yep,
but we didn't have time to put the picture up, and this is a viewer in Lincoln who saw the segment on Sundancer buffalo grass.
Nice.
And so planted it, and so there it is, and they want to know how often to water and how long will it take for it to do anything, and when should they start spraying for weed control?
Yeah, so buffalo grass is a little bit like bluegrass. You need to be patient, but on that picture, it looks like it's, you know, been seeded well, it's covered. Keeping it moist now is going to be the most important thing that we can do to make sure that it goes. I'm sure he got treated seed of Sundancer, and we generally expect it's going to germinate in about, you know, 21 to maybe 28 days. With it being as warm as it is right now, closer to the 21 days we'd probably be there. So be patient. You know, if it's not growing, that's okay. It's going to happen. It's nice and warm out. It's going to like it. And from a weed control perspective, it was amazing looking at our research plots today. You know, going out with that application of Tenacity at seeding and then a couple weeks after seeding, it really does a great job of keeping those annual weeds like crabgrass at bay. Start watering that soil, the crabgrass, the goosegrass, the foxtail wants to get going. So if you use that pre-emergent tenacity and keep it wet, you should have a great looking lawn pretty soon.
Excellent. Thanks, Bill. Okay, Lauren, this is an oozing oak, 45 feet tall. It's a pin oak. They found this area about 8 feet above the ground that looks like soap bubbles are coming out of it and oozing. It's discolored. What is going on?
Well, unfortunately, when you see these types of things on trees, it's usually some sort of infection inside. So there's a condition known as wetwood that we see in a lot of our trees. That's usually a bacterial infection that can get in there. It's probably got something else in there as well, would be my guess. So I would really watch that tree for overall decline. The other thing I'd watch it for is just, you know, as far as any thinning in the tree, if it's in a situation that it could be a hazard tree. So anytime we see anything on the trunk, or we see cankers or anything like this, it's really a flag to watch it, make sure it's going to be okay and it's a safe tree in the landscape.
All right. Excellent. Thanks, Lauren. All right, Jeff, two Bradford pears and one crab apple, the same issue. They're calling them root-like things coming out of the ground.
Right.
They wonder what they are and what they can do about it.
Well, they've got a terrible case of the suckers on both those trees. So, and it's, you know, that's a tough one. We get that question an awful lot with suckering on crabs and pears. You know, typically what you have is you have your rootstock, so it's that grafted top onto a rootstock, and that rootstock is now creating its own woody stem. And many times, you know, weather conditions can kind of trigger it. Heavy pruning is typically for us on campus one of the issues that will kind of trigger that response in a tree, and it's hard to get it to stop. And they talked about cutting them back, and they've been working that, and to me that would be the one solution I would suggest is just keep with cutting them back. Don't let them get well established. But you may also want to consider replacing these trees. You know, you don't have to do it immediately. Maybe get one started in the vicinity with the idea that once it gets big enough, you can remove it. But I think that's probably where we're at. I don't think these trees will ever turn into something that they really want.
Right. So yeah, once it starts, it
keeps, it's hard. Yeah, it's hard to get it to stop.
Going. All right. Well, at Union Plaza, a surety happens to be right next door. It's a great company. It was a catalyst for all of the development in the Antelope Valley area. And one of the really great things they did is they decided that they would go a bit away from a traditional landscape for this building, celebrate Nebraska style, do some installation of some things that really belong here.
The Assurity Center is the first large LEED Gold certified building in the city of Lincoln. LEED stands for Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. And we're proud of a lot of the sustainable features of the Assurity Center, but especially our landscaping. We have a lot of cool sustainable features in our landscaping. While we were doing the construction, we discovered a 180,000 gallon culvert on the north edge of the property, and we converted it into a cistern system. So all the water off of the very top roof, we also have permeable pavement, flows into the cistern, and from there we irrigate the rest of the grounds. We've got bioswales, rain gardens. We've got 8,000 square feet of green roof space, and the south side is set up to look like a Nebraska prairie. All the species that we planted here are native species. I think we have over 75 species that are native to the Great Plains region. The building was designed with a smaller footprint, a 25,000 square foot per floor footprint, so that all of our associates, or most of them, can work with natural light. So the Assurity Center has a lot of great sustainable features. The grounds was designed to blend into the new Union Plaza Park and to be consistent with that. Our landscape architect was the Clark Anderson firm, who also did the landscaping for Union Plaza Park. So they made sure that our landscaping was complementary of what occurred in Union Plaza Park. You know, it's been an evolving process. We've learned a lot of things. One of the things that has been a challenge for us has been our green roofs. Especially the roofs to the north. We found that climate is a little harsher over there. We've had to replant with some other species. We've gone to more succulent species on the north side of the building to reflect the harsher environment there. We've had some challenges with some of our other species, and that one of the first years that we were in was 2012. Some of you remember 2012. It was a very dry and difficult year, and so we had to do quite a bit of replanting in 2013. We have some undeveloped real estate to the north of the Assurity Center that we tried in 2012 to sow them to pollinators, and trying to develop more bee habitat here in the city. Unfortunately, again, 2012 was a difficult year from a drought standpoint. Then we subsequently had someone we thought was going to want to develop that property. It turned out that they're now not interested. So we're considering going ahead and developing that into habitat for pollinators next year.
So the grounds really does not end at the sidewalk. There's this great blending of the public space and the private space, and the sharing, of course, for the pollinators and all the critters, because they don't know where that property line is anyway. Thanks to Tom Henning for doing that, and for Assurity for doing that with us. Okay, you get the next picture question, Tom.
Sweet.
This is a viewer with a maple. White fuzzy growth along the lower branches, leaves dying where the growth exists. What is it, and how do it be treated?
Flying mice.
It is not.
You want more?
No, more. Okay. More is better.
Those are woolly aphids. Woolly aphids get a nice start in the springtime. Little nymphs. The little nymphs they get plumper and fatter, and they're just like these really meaty, tiny insects. But as they get older, they start to produce filaments of wax on their body. And these filaments of wax grow and grow and grow. And actually, the filaments of wax, you're going, why do they have that? I'll tell you. That's to avoid predation. A predator tries to grab them, they get the waxy filament instead of the actual insect, they can get away. But what happens later in the summer, well, midsummer, they start to grow wings. So they're fluffy little insects on there, start to grow wings, and they'll take flight. Just the other day I was walking and they were just all over the place, looked like little snowflakes falling. And so they get the name flying mice, flying dandruff, fairy flies, things like that. And they're just dispersing off to a new host. So generally what happens when this time of the year they're dispersing, their problem's going to go away. And I know there was some brown limb on that tree that was being shown. Just trim it off, everything will be fine.
All right, excellent. And I thought you were kidding about flying mice, but apparently you were not.
I don't kid, Kim.
Uh-huh. Right. Okay, Bill, so we have a viewer who has a pretty dry spot in their yard in a nice straight line. It says this has been happening for 3 to 4 years. What do we think is going on here?
So this is an example of why we need to know what's going on in our soil and what's going on beneath our plants and our turf. And too often, you know, we build a house, we have construction go on around our house, then we come back in, we fill soil in, usually it's, you know, high clay soil, and then we compact it really, really tight to make sure that it's stable and that those pipes are protected. And so it just happens that this same patch happens where the homeowner said there's a utility corridor. And so you have to think, you know, what's causing the damage here? Is it getting disease and drought because it's, you know, a natural thing? That straight line would say no. So then we look at other things. What would have caused that straight line? Well, that's something that man probably did. In this case, it's a utility corridor. And so that soil probably is pretty poor. We can try to amend it with compost. We can try to make sure it's draining properly so it doesn't stay wet and get diseases like pythium or brown patch. But ultimately, it's just, you know, a kind of neglect of the soil that's leading to this situation. If it's really bad, you'd want to till in some compost and then re-solder seed on top of it to try to prevent that from happening in the future.
All right, excellent. Thanks, Bill. Okay, Lauren, black spots on black-eyed Susans. Mm. This particular viewer gets them every year. He does say he waters overhead, if that gives you a little hint.
Well, and that's, yeah, because this is a very common, some of the foliar diseases that we see on Rudbeckia. So this is Septoria. Residue borne, so in the leaf litter. So some things you can do, you know, in the winter months is use sanitation and clean it up, but that overhead irrigation is definitely going to aggravate the situation and provide that moisture for those spores of the fungus to grow, germinate, and reinfect. So that's the first thing I'd recommend, is try to avoid overhead irrigation. If you have to do that, that this hits in your landscape, just make sure it's in the morning. So Those leaves that are wet from irrigation will actually dry a little bit quicker than just dew leaves. So if you do that early in the morning, that'll help that as well. You can use a fungicide. Typically, though, I hate to recommend fungicides on something like Rutabaga. It's not going to kill the plant. You're going to have some leaf spots. You can use some sanitation measures to clean it up and then kind of go with it that way.
All right. Excellent. Thanks, Lauren. Well, the reach of NET and Backyard Farmer and Nebraska Extension is wonderful, Jeff, because your question is from South Dakota.
Wow.
And this is the viewer with a honey locust, and it has all sorts of issues on the trunk and one dead limb in particular. His series of questions is whether it's time to give it up or could he go ahead and limp along with it for a bit, treat it.
Right, right. Well, looking at the photos, you know, it looks like we do have a pretty good sized wound on the tree, and there's a lot of dead in the tree. Mm-hmm. So throughout the tree. At the same time, it's a decent sized tree, and the crown seems to be more or less alive. You know, I guess my suggestion, and again, kind of like the previous answer, is to go in, we want to clean that up, take all the dead out, take any of those limbs out that have a lot of wounds on them or some cankers on them, go ahead and get that cleaned up. And then I would go in and think about replacing it, leave the tree in place, but find a location nearby. Give yourself enough room to remove that tree in the future, but look at maybe adding some trees now. You let that tree be there to help kind of nurse those new trees along, provide a little protection for them. And then when you're ready, then you can go ahead and remove that tree and you'll be good to go.
Excellent. Thanks, Jeff. It's pretty hard to be thinking about a nice, cool fall garden when the temperatures are hitting 100, but that's exactly what Extension Assistant Terry James is going to be talking about in the Backyard Farmer Garden this week.
This week in the Backyard Farmer Garden, we're doing a little planning. We're actually looking forward to what we can plant for our fall garden. What you need to do is you need to figure out what you'd like. Some of those shorter crops, green beans, radishes, carrots, peas, those are really the ones that you're gonna have to look at to see if you can actually get them in the garden and actually get a full season crop before it actually starts getting cold. On the eastern side of Nebraska, October 10th is about the frost date. Western Nebraska, it's about a week earlier. So count back how many days from harvest, it says on the back of that seed packet, and count how many days you have before you need to plant it. We have some green beans and some peas started for our fall crop, and they are just emerging, so you can see those little cotyledons and those first true leaves on those plants. So they look really cute in our raised beds. So that's what's happening in the Backyard Farmer Garden this week. Stop by and take a look.
Go out there, pick a spot, head off to the garden centers and grab those seeds before it's too late and start thinking cool temperatures for that Backyard Farmer Garden and for your own garden. All right, Tom, you get a viewer question.
Okay.
This is fun. They say they have not heard the cicadas yet. I've heard the cicadas, but then their follow-up question is, does that mean winter is 80 days away? What is that old bug tale? You don't know, so it must not be true.
I lived a long time in Florida, Kim, so I'm not really sure. I heard cicadas about June 15th, I think, in my home in Waverly. But I've not. I've heard more stories about woolly bears and their color spots bands than I have about cicadas and buzzing. But at the same time, it does seem a little bit early this year. So.
I think it's early. That's okay.
Let's hope we get an early winter.
All right, Bill, last week Matt answered a question real quickly about little barley. Didn't have much time to follow through on it. Could you elaborate a little bit on little barley and whether that falls into your windmill grass problem situation?
Yeah, I could.
You're not going to?
Little barley, put me on, I don't know.
Annual.
It's an annual, but I don't know how you would kill it now. I'm sorry.
You wouldn't? You wouldn't?
Oh, okay.
See how this works, audience? If we don't know, we just bat back and forth.
Still need a live show. I see how this is. Thanks, Kim.
Yeah. No, it's annual. It's already gone to seed. It's dead and gone.
Okay.
Dead and gone. All right. Lauren, your question from the audience. We'll see if we can stump you, too.
Well, it's getting hot, so we're all just kind of losing our brains.
Exactly.
That's it.
Tomatoes are beginning to show some really distinct and terrible issues right now. especially sort of this curling on the top foliage. Mm-hmm. Are we talking about a blight of some sort or a heat response, do you
think?
Well,
if it's curling on the top foliage, there's a few things. I mean, if it's an individual plant that's curling, you know, we think about, you know, herbicide injury, and with the warm days, you know, hopefully nobody was spraying, but that's one of the first things I think of. We're getting to the point now where there may be some fruit as well, so if you would see any association of banding on the fruit or discoloration, it's probably a virus and you should rogue it out. There can be some environmental changes and you can get some foliage deformation just from rapid growth periods, and so periods of high temperatures and then, you know, cooler and wet and everything just kind of going back and forth where you can get some defoliation, or not defoliation, but distortion of that leaf growth. So it could be that as well. So if all of them are being affected uniformly and it's extreme cupping, I would say it's herbicides, and hopefully that's not the case, but it could be. The other one is then it would be just the moisture, and it would grow out of it, the heat.
All right, thanks, so. Lauren. Jeff, we'll stay on the tomato thing right now, and we also will talk peppers and cucumbers, and that would be that they are not blooming. They did spray an animal repellent of some sort, and they're wondering whether the repellent is the cause, or are we yet in our strange weather conditions?
Yeah, you know, well, with our heat that we had, that could have delayed blooming a little bit, especially if nighttime temps didn't cool off a little. But as far as the spray, especially if it was an animal repellent, I'm less concerned about that damaging anything. I know my pumpkins are blooming at home. My tomatoes are blooming. I'm not having any issues right now, but I guess I am a backyard farmer, so I'm not supposed to be having any issues. But
that doesn't work for me.
It doesn't? Oh, okay. Sorry. I'll come to your yard. But anyway, so I would say that maybe, you know, I'd look at their watering schedule, how they're watering, make sure that we're not overhead watering, and make sure that we're not letting things dry out too much, and that may be part of it. If you're getting caught on some of those days that you think that you've watered enough, and you haven't, and so that may be interrupting some of our blooms.
Right now it is time for Plant of the Week, and Jeff, those were actually, might have been found somewhere on property, I'm just saying.
Yeah, well, and they look like it. from the standpoint that they look like native plants, okay, not that they look poorly.
Kind of a good recovery.
Yeah, right. Our first one we're looking at, this purplish lilac colored flower, is a Monarda. And it's one of our native Monardas. So it's a little unusual. I know my Monarda at home has a scarlet flower. It's just starting to bloom right now. And it doesn't do this tiered effect that this has here. But so this is kind of cool. So you remember our Monardas have a square stem. They're part of the mint family, so they're very fragrant. And the butterflies love them. The bees love them. I know when mine are in bloom with the hyssop, they're just covered in bees and butterflies. And the smaller plant we have is an allium, so one of the in the onion family. And I think we have some onion questions tonight, so it's kind of a popular plant this week. So allium and Monarda.
Excellent. And I finally remembered the common name of that one. It's spotted horse mint.
Spotted
horse mint for the Monarda. All right. Okay, Tom, it must be interesting, large caterpillar-like creature, because we had two viewers, both from the eastern part of the state, send us images of this thing, and it is on their tomatoes.
Seriously, this thing? Uh-huh. It's a beautiful creature, Ken.
Beautiful creature, that beautiful thing.
Well, that is a hornworm, number one. And you're gonna know it's a hornworm because right on its butt, it's got a horn. And that gives it its common name. That one happens to be a tobacco hornworm, and there's two closely related. One's tobacco and one's tomato. So that had just one stripe that went along the side of its body on each of the segments, but a tomato hornworm has two stripes, so it makes kind of a V, and everybody's going, who cares? Just want to know what it's all about. Now, what happens in the early summer, the moths come out, nice females, and the females are actually called hummingbird moths, sphinx moths, and they actually fly around, they go to nectar to feed. In the evenings, you'll see them, they'll look just like a little hummingbird out there flying around. But they're going to find solanaceous plants. So it could be eggplant, could be tomato, maybe peppers, but they're gonna lay eggs on it, and then these little larvae are gonna start to eat. And you won't even notice them. And they'll eat, and they'll eat, and they'll continue to eat until they get about the size of almost a hot dog they just get absolutely huge and plump, and that's when you notice them. By that time, a lot of the damage is done, and they're going to drop off the plant, go into the ground and pupate, unless you were to intervene and pull them off the plant. Now, a lot of times what happens with these things is they are magnets for parasitoids. And what you might see are little things that look like Q-tips coming out of them. And those are actually the pupal cases for a little parasitic wasp called Braconid wasp. And that's a good thing. You want to let them go, let those little wasps come out. But the unfortunate part of it is they've done a lot of damage before they get to that part. So what we're trying to do is prevent the adults from emerging. So hand picking is a great way to do it. If you really need to spray something, Bacillus thuringiensis is awesome. And if you wait till fall, because they do go down to pupate in the soil for the winter, get a rototiller out there in the fall after you've got all your tomatoes off there and rototill the heck out of that ground and try to destroy the pupae.
Excellent. All right. Thanks, Tom. Okay, Bill, we're not going to stump you on this one.
Okay.
This is thin turf, and it is something that looks remarkably like a strawberry.
Yep.
Coming up through this thin turf, and she wonders how to control, what is it, how to control it, and is it poisonous for her dogs?
Well, it's wild strawberry, it's not poisonous, and that thin turf part is really the key word there. You know, why is it thin? Well, it's probably a little bit shaded, so that's something that you're going to be fighting right away. But then doing things like mowing high, proper nitrogen fertilization, watering, you know, mowing, it's amazing what mowing frequently can do. Just it can really clean up a lot of these weeds. And so if you're, you know, relying on scalping and that grass is thinning out, you know, you're becoming more reliant on these chemical control options. And so just being up on your fertility and your proper mowing is going to do a lot. If you have this, it's a pretty aggressive plant, and so you're going to need to use some stronger herbicides post-emergence to kill them. We don't do that in the fall. And so something with like triclopyr in there is going to be really important to help take care of this, because the three-way mixes by themselves are marginally effective against this pretty resilient plant.
All right, excellent. Thanks, Bill. I have that in my yard, so there we go. Okay, Lauren, we had this question earlier from the eastern part of the state. Now this is a viewer from the Lexington area. She has this white stuff on her nine bark and is wondering what this is. She's never seen it before and what to do about it.
I think it's powdery mildew from what we can tell looking at the picture, which is kind of unique. And I guess one of the things that, you know, and I haven't seen this personally on nine bark before, but the newer growth is being affected. So that newer growth like that, when it gets covered, you know, in those buds, maybe that's just a little bit more favorable condition for the fungus to grow on the leaf surfaces if there's more exudation and things like that, which those would all used to grow and occur. So I don't know that I would do a lot with this though, unless it's, you know, if it's a young plant, an establishment, you can spray a fungicide. Probably the best thing to do is just hose it off with water, because free moisture on the leaves can reduce powdery mildew. So I wouldn't really recommend treating it though. It's not going to kill the plant anyway. So.
All right. Thanks, Lauren. Jeff, this may bounce to next week.
Okay.
But you get it first. A viewer in the Council Bluffs area in the country. Three red oaks with leaves that are beginning to curl.
Right.
She wants to know what to do, whether it's from the early spring moisture. I did notice one on campus that is doing essentially the same thing, and the one next to it is not.
Right.
Is this environmental, or is this insect pest or path?
You know, I was looking at, and I guess Lauren can chime in if he thinks this path. I was looking at some of the oak wilts and kind of comparing them, and they don't look the same. There's no dead on these leaves. They're really curled. To me, they really exhibit growth regulator sort of damage. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that there's a lot of question in my mind that is what's going on in this case. And I know that she mentioned she didn't spray. You know, those products, and we've had a warm year, can travel a long distance if they're applied incorrectly on a windy day. So I think that's what's really happened in this case. And I guess if this is an annual thing, you know, some of the other things we start looking at with red oaks in particular that have leaf distortions that we can't explain through pathology is something like a circling root, so a stem girdling root, some root damage. If you look at the base of the tree and you see large roots going across the trunk, many times those trees will look good in the spring, they'll leaf out pretty well, and then they start showing stress as we get into hotter days, because they just can't keep up with the drawing moisture out of the ground, because they're kind of cutting their their neck off there with their stem girdling roots. So I think that's the other thing that maybe I'd be watching as well, looking at some of the roots around the base of the tree and see if we have something going on with that.
All right, thanks, Jeff.
I'll just add in to Jeff on that. You know, a lot of times people don't realize how different species are sensitive to herbicides. So
right.
Like a red oak compared to other trees in the landscape may not have any injury. So
yeah.
It can still be herbicide that drifts in from any property and,
sure.
and just affect that one plant.
All right, okay. Tom, you get a question from a viewer here, and it's kind of a fun one as well. It's sort of fun insect night. And what this one is how many kinds of praying mantises are there?
In the world?
Take a guess. And how do you tell the difference?
How about in Nebraska?
How about in Nebraska?
Oh, okay. In Nebraska, we have two.
Just two.
Just two.
Just
at least
two.
That I'm aware of. We have the Carolina mantid, which is actually a native one that this is its normal range, and then the introduced one, which is a Chinese mantid, which is an absolute huge thing. I love that one. And they got attitude. They're so much fun to mess with. but all praying mantids are great. I mean, they do some beneficial things, but you got to remember that they're out there eating a pest just as well as eating a honeybee off a plant. So
gotcha.
Yeah, so I'm good with the bad.
All right, thanks, Tom. Okay, Bill, interesting question about trumpet vine.
Okay.
And the plant has done what it does, which is come up all over the lawn. They want to know, is there a herbicide that will treat something that does that in the lawn without translocating back them into the main plant? So if you think of any of those kinds of landscape ornamentals that do that.
Yeah, no, it's... It'd be tough. I'd rather just mechanically try to prune it out. You could do something. There are herbicides that are non-selective contacts that if you sprayed it on it, it would kill that type of a plant, like trumpet vine, but it would also kill the grass underneath of it. So, you know, a weed whip would be the worst thing you could possibly do, would be better than herbicide, and maybe just try to cut that way to keep things separated. But, you know, getting those plants into that landscape, the grass in the landscape and the plants out of the lawn, mechanical is generally the best thing to do.
All right, thanks, Bill. Oak night, Lauren. Now we have a swamp white oak question. This is from Norfolk. And they're saying that it's about 15 years old, the leaves are dropping, and it looks like the petiole attachment to the twig is twisted. Herbicide,
leaves
insect,
are dropping, petiole twist.
Scratch of the head, send a picture.
Yeah, I think on that, maybe send a picture. I don't know if it's twisted, if that would be herbicide, but the leaf drop wouldn't match at all. So, yeah, I don't know on that one. I think I'd want to see a picture. So,
all right.
Sorry about that. Just to add in on the trumpet vine, I think everybody should plant one of those so they have something to do in the future.
Yeah, let's not do that.
Yeah.
Okay, Jeff, a couple of questions from viewers that had damage in deciduous trees.
Okay.
And it was storm related in May. Now they're seeing dead limbs or dying limbs in those trees. The question is whether this is the time when they should be pruning those dead or dying limbs out, or do they need to wait until fall?
You know, if there's any time that you have dead or dying plant material in your trees or shrubs or even your perennials, you know, that's the time to go ahead and take it out. So, you know, use a nice cool morning or a cooler evening to go out and do some of that work and take some of that dead out. But we don't want to keep that dead plant material in there. Otherwise, then you're asking Lauren questions about what to do with some of that. So anyway.
All right. Thanks. Well, here we are at pretty brand new Union Plaza. Let's take a look now at our national treasure in Lincoln, which is Sunken Gardens, and a very, very wonderful event where volunteers do everything annually to make it look absolutely beautiful.
In 1905, the land was given to the city by the Fry family. They owned a series of greenhouses in town, and so it sort of sat here for almost 30-some years until 1930, when Ernest Behr, who was a city commissioner, decided that he needed to do something to lift the spirits of people in Lincoln that were going through depression at the time. So in the 1930s is when the idea for building a garden here actually started. That's when they started to piece together the monies to build it. and then how to hire people to put it in. And it was developed with the idea of just being a very, very beautiful place is all it really was.
This is the 85th year that the garden has been planted. Every year we do this, what we call Wake Up the Beds, which is the annual planting of sunken gardens, and it's a great opportunity to get the community involved. We plant over 30,000 annuals, and it's something people look forward to. And without the help of the community, it would really be a challenge to get it done.
The thing that I think that is amazing is that Lincoln has continued to embrace this. And in some communities, this would have gone away, but not in Lincoln. You know, it gets better and better every year and gets more and more support.
So we get about 100 volunteers, and then we have staff, and we divide into teams. And we kind of do a planting demonstration, showing people how to properly plant the annuals. And then it's really just kind of you have camaraderie with your team as you go through the different areas of the park, and by the end of the day you've created new friendships and gotten to know people that you might not otherwise get to know.
Alice Reed and I redesign the annual garden every year, and the process involved is basically coming up with an idea that is very colorful, because that's what annuals can do. And we sort of tie different elements together in the design. We like to have a good color play, but we like to, like this year, it's all things Seuss. We want to play off of something that everybody's familiar with.
I think this is going to be great this year. Lots of pattern, lots of color. I'm always impressed what Steve and Alice do every year to come up with a new theme. We have people asking us well in advance, what is the theme going to be for next year? They always want to know what the theme is for the current year. The amazing thing about this place is the bananas will be probably 8, 10, 12 foot tall, the caladiums with leaves, you know, as big as hula hoops, and I think the kids just have a great place. This is truly a magical place. They come down here, and there's no place like this in Lincoln. There's no place like this probably within the region. It's just an amazing place.
It's just beautiful every single year. People get married, people just stroll and wander around. It's really fun to go and see how that develops. And again, to do that with all those volunteers with Parks and Rec is pretty fabulous. Okay, Tom, mystery insect year. This is from Nance County. She found these little guys in a flower bed, and as she watched, they raised half their bodies off the leaf and then went back down again. Any thoughts on that? Or
boy,
do we need to see them when they grow up?
Yeah, that would be, this is like Stumpus night, isn't it?
It's not my fault.
Weather gets a little bit warm and you get a little bit feisty over there. You know, I'm really trying to base it, I'm really stumped on, okay, for a couple reasons. One, I'm trying to base an answer based on the leaf. It looks like a thistle leaf to me. I'm a bug guy, not a plant. I get a nod, yeah, probably a thistle leaf. I would be inclined to say the shape of them puts them at some kind of another one of these tortoise beetles, like maybe a thistle tortoise beetle, you know, the ones that put the poop on their back that we talked about earlier, similar to that.
Okay.
And so a thistle tortoise beetle, and that could be a larval stage, maybe it's pupal stage. I was inclined to think it's more pupal stage, but it's got that white stuff on it, and that's, I can't figure that out. So I'm thinking maybe it's been moist, maybe we got a little bit of secondary fungal growth on there, Bavaria bassiana, which is common on some insects. But if they're rearing up, they're still alive and doing well, so maybe it's not.
Okay, so maybe we'll see if it'll, we're just gonna make something up. Let's just go with that.
We're gonna fill more shows in 100 degree weather. We really should do this.
Let's do our brains
so
are fried.
Much better.
But I wasn't done, you just cut me.
Yeah, you're done. You're done.
I had so much more to say.
All right, Bill.
Yeah.
We have a viewer who has daylilies and other ornamentals in landscape bed. Mm-hmm. And wonders, is there a post-emergent spray that will kill the grass that has crept in around daylilies in particular without killing everything else?
Yeah, I'd be really careful with any kind of herbicides right around my landscape plants. Something like Roundup too, just like you hear about these growth regulating post-emergent herbicides or selective like 2,4-D. Roundup can also be very volatile. So if you're out there even glove of deathing, I would be pretty concerned. So first thing I would do is look to see what kind of grass you have in there. Is it Kentucky bluegrass? Probably, if it's creeping in. So we know we have some rhizome issues. So it's probably coming in from the adjacent lawn. If you can do like a nice edge there to help prevent those rhizomes from getting in, you're gonna get some, but then that will help a little bit and keep it edged. And then just try to pull it as possible. And if you really are trying to need to use some kind of a herbicide, you know, level of death, but make sure it is not when it is, you know, hot and sunny out or stagnant. You really, it could help cause some issues. Kim was even brainstorming with me before the show about maybe you could even cover some plants that might have this issue, and you could round up around them and hope that roundup is gone or into the plant before you take the cover off the plant. So it's a little bit of a challenge, but just try to figure out if it's a bunch type grass, you could pull it. If it's a rhizomatous grass like Kentucky bluegrass, then you're going to have to be a little bit more aggressive.
All right, thank you, Bill. Lauren, a Hebron viewer, has burning bush that's starting to burn. They did, and a second viewer sent in the same question, actually. Mm-hmm. They've put black mulch around last year. They're wondering if they could cause that. But then it looks like they have that, we call it flashing, when they all of a sudden half the plant dies. Mm-hmm. Any ideas, or does this go to entomology next week?
Well, and somebody else might chime in. Anytime I see shrubs or bushes that change color like a burning bush, not at the normal time of year. I mean, it's obviously stressed, but if you have a certain portion of that bush that's affected, if you can look and see if there's any injury. I tried to zoom in on the picture to see if I could see anything, you know, in the base of the plant, if there was some injury or something. But usually that is what's going on. Now the top growth of the plant looks fine though. So that's what kind of threw me up for a loop on it. But I would really just watch it carefully. I wouldn't do any aggressive pruning at all or take anything away. I don't know that the mulch is a problem, although if it's really hot and dry and that mulch was adding to the heat load there in some way and you weren't watering it properly, then that could be a problem, and that could result in some of those lower leaves falling out and defoliating like that. So I just check the moisture on it. If it's in good shape, I'd leave it alone and just watch it.
All right. Thank you, Lauren. Johnson Lake, Jeff. And this is a houseplant question. So we're going from trees in South Dakota to houseplants in central Nebraska. Excuse me. It's a Dracaena. It has had white flies at times. Now the leaves are sort of drooping. Mm-hmm. And they're wondering how they can save it. It is in an atrium, so they say it does get enough light.
Okay. Well, the nice thing about Dracaenas is that they do tolerate low light. That's why they're common in... They're a good house plant. You'll see them in businesses, that sort of thing. So, you know, again, you may almost have a little bit too much light, perhaps, for this particular plant. The other thing to think about is, you know, if you're not potting this up, because this is a pretty good sized plant, if you're not increasing the size of the pot by an inch every couple of years, then that may be contributing to the fact that we're not getting the proper amount of root growth for the size of the plant and is struggling that way. You know, they don't require a lot of moisture, but they require even moisture. You have to watch fertilizer. You don't want to use any kind of high nitrogen fertilizer. They're temperamental to some of the micronutrients in some of our higher fertilizers. So maybe a lower nitrogen kind of organic sort of fertilizer would be better for something like this. So, you know, it's a really easy plant to grow. It's a big one. It's been around a long time. So I would say look at repotting, getting rid of some of that old potting mix, putting in some new potting mix, a little bit bigger pot, and my guess it'll probably recover.
All right.
And just to chime in a little bit on Lauren's question, you know, burning bush have incredibly fibrous root systems that are relatively shallow. So I think he was absolutely on the money when you got to check the moisture and then the mulch. And that mulch may be sealing that area, not allowing some of our rains to get in there. So that would be the one thing. But if I've seen some of our fibrous roots, Canadian cherry dogwood, burning bush, some of the forsythia, are very fibrous, shallow-rooted plants. And so they are very temperamental to big swings in moisture and heat. And that's when we'll see some of those things fire off like that.
All right, excellent. Good point, Jeff. Okay, Tom, we had a viewer say that their zucchini over the 4th of July collapsed like it got hit by a firework. Only it wasn't fireworks, it was that little squash vine borer.
Yes.
too late? What do we suggest now?
I would go after the things as much as you can and try to remove them. You don't want them trying to get to the adult stage because he could have a problem next year. So go through, try to find the swellings in the vines and cut them open, try to find the larvae and kill them. Them in.
All right. Swat them.
Yeah.
One way or the other.
Just somehow kill them.
All right. Thanks, Tom. Bindweed in turf, Bill. How do we kill bindweed? And the mowing doesn't seem to have done it on this particular one.
Yeah, bindweed's kind of funny, actually. The same herbicide that you use to kill bindweed is what you use to kill crabgrass. And so even though you got a grass versus, you know, a broadleaf weed, going out with crabgrass killer quincrack, it'll actually be really effective on bindweed, and bindweed's a big issue in Nebraska. And so we've had really good success with that, especially if it's in with another couple herbicides. And so if you are doing that, just spot spray. You don't need the broadcast spray. If you see it popping up, you know, we just hit it with a little quincrack and it knocks it out pretty good. So.
All right. Lauren, mm-hmm. Lily of the Valley, which a lot of people actually wish they didn't have. We have someone who gets a leaf spot or some sort of a leaf spot on their Lily of the Valley and wonders if we've seen it and is there anything we think we could do about it. We don't know where they're from. We don't have a location.
I'd love to see a picture of it. And I haven't looked at Lily of the Valley a lot, but I don't know why. I'm thinking it gets a rust maybe. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know that I would worry about trying to control it. If you have Lily of the Valley, you probably have more than you need. So. I don't know that I'd worry too much about it. Overhead irrigation is going to aggravate any of our foliar diseases, so if you can avoid that, that would be the main thing. If it is a rust, like I think Lily of the Valley gets, maybe we can get somebody to get back with them on that. Maybe next week Kevin can comment on that if it is, but it shouldn't be overwintering here typically. They'll blow in each year. So.
Okay, excellent. Okay, Jeff, two or three peony questions. One of them being it's been such a great year for peonies, they're humongous. And can they go ahead and take that foliage off now? And the other being, if they don't want to take the foliage off, should they at least cut the spent flower heads or the seeds off?
Well, you certainly can. So any of that's, if the tops are looking a little rough, you can prune some of that off and cut some of that off. The seeds actually can be fairly, I think, ornamental. I think they're kind of fun. And I've actually started other peonies from seed, just playing around with them. So, you know, that could be a good family garden project. But, you know, my peonies are looking great. They're like miniature shrubs in the front yard right now. So prune off the stuff that's looking a little rough. But, you know, we want to hold off for now. We want to get as much energy into that plant as we can here till we look at dividing and cutting back later this summer.
All right, thank you, Jeff. Well, we have an announcement of something that we think is pretty fun in the gardening world, and that would be a very first Backyard Farmer Garden open house, Saturday, July 16th, 10 to 12, UNL East Campus. We'll strut our stuff, and of course, our master gardeners and Extension Assistant Terry James are instrumental in making that look perfect for all of our visitors. So come join us that morning. It'll be perfect weather. Absolutely perfect. Okay, Tom, perfect question. So
sure. We
had two people actually ask us this week, is it early for monarchs? Is it late? When should they actually see the monarch butterfly, him or herself, flying around as opposed to simply the milkweed flowering?
I had first sighting a monarch adult and they were happening in mid-June-ish, you know, early to mid-June. So we were seeing them around Lincoln and Omaha. And it's the right time of year. They've migrated up multiple generations coming from Mexico. So we have generation now here that came in that time of year and they went out to seacoast plants, lay their eggs, and we try to get generation after generation. But I just saw some monarchs last weekend. So we seem to be cycling through them. Unfortunately, we don't seem to be seeing as many as we've normally seen. So we'll get a few more generations here throughout the rest of the summer. Just keep an eye out for them. And if you see them, get onto social media and report it because it's a celebration anymore.
All right. Bill, you have 10 seconds to tell me exactly when we should think about seeding for the fall turf.
I would seed in the fall, starting in the middle of August. So if you're going to do that and you're renovating, round up a couple times before to really make sure you get that thing clean and seed in the middle of August.